So I'm a medical engineer and entrepreneur on a mission to revolutionize something you and I do all the time without even thinking about it. Taking a breath. But what's actually happening during every breath we take? And I encourage you to join me in a little exercise. Please put all, you can stay relaxed in the seat, no worries. Put your hand on your belly, one hand on your belly. That's great. The other hand on your chest. So now breathe in through your nose into your belly. And your chest should stay relatively calm. Don't try to look beautiful, really, into the belly. It should go rise during inspiration and return during expiration. And who of you had a relatively calm chest? For whom was it easy to do this? Please raise your hand and breathe into your belly. This is quite representative because about 10% of the population has some paradox breathing, some different type of breathing, but it's actually quite important to breathe with your diaphragm. It's known to reduce blood pressures, reduce your heart rate, and it's like a power tool during stressful situation because it makes you think more clear. So it was quite nice today to start with this diaphragmatic breathing exercise on stage. So, but let's look a little bit closer to what's actually happening. This diaphragm is our core breathing muscle. When it contracts, the belly rises. And to make it contract, the brain is actually constantly sending breathing signals down via nerve to the diaphragm. So it starts from the brain, goes down via the nerve to the diaphragm. And it's working out for us 20,000 times per day. So while you relax and don't even think about it, your diaphragm is doing a workout for you 20,000 times per day. And those signals, actually for every second of breath you take, there's 25 action potentials. Each action potential has thousands of little nerves firing and about a million of ions going through little channels, all for a second of breathing. So the brain and the diaphragm are communicating to each other constantly, all the time. But this is not possible for patients on mechanical ventilators. They get a tube into their throat. They get on medication and sedation. The ventilator is forcing air inside their lungs. It's not natural. And because of the suppressed brain, there's no action potentials, no breathing. So imagine you go from 20,000 times to no breathing, what that makes to your body. This is Oliver, sitting here in the audience. My husband, he worked in critical care, and he remembers one particular patient. His name was Benno. He remembers this patient because this patient also had suppressed brain function, but he remembered him and thanked him. So Benno was actually, before he came to the hospital, he was a worker. He worked on very high electric towers. He worked with high voltage electric power cables. And one day he was up there in a electric tower and he fell down all the way from that tower to the ground. Oliver received him as a working in critical care on the ventilator. His brain signals got suppressed. He got intubated. He was ventilated for a couple of days. And when you go from a very high, strong man to being very passive, to 20,000 times contracting to basically zero, this diaphragm shrinks by 50% of the muscle fibers are gone after only 3 days of no breathing and no brain signals and no diaphragmatic function. So this is massive. And then caregivers like Oliver and the patient together have to retrain breathing again. So maybe the underlying disease, in this case, multiple trauma, rib cages broken, as you can imagine, is kind of in a good state, patient is stabilized, could potentially come off the ventilator, but no, you cannot come off. You have to rebuild that diaphragm, rebuild that breathing muscle, which takes another few days, unnecessary being stuck on the ventilator. But it's not only that breathing muscle getting lost. The communication between the brain and the diaphragm is going in two ways. So it's the signals are guiding from the brain down to the diaphragm, but also there is some kind of feedback going back to the brain. So it's not only the diaphragm is shrinking, it's also some brain cells shrinking. That's an early evidence, but that's kind of emerging evidence that it's also the brain may be affected. The other thing, when you kind of have overpressures in your lung, then this is not a natural pressure distribution that the body knows. So this is causing a different pressure distribution in the lung. And the other thing, if you don't contract the diaphragm and you have these high pressures in your lung, then also the backflow to the heart is affected. So long story short, it's not only the diaphragm that's affected. There's also some impact on the venous blood flow to the heart and the brain. And because our body is really like a fine-tuned system, if one little thing is off balance, it can affect other parts of the body. So there is, however, about 15 million ventilated patients and about 3 million patients are on the ventilator multiple days like Benno every year. So Oliver thought, there must be a better way. We can do this better. So I added to this hypothesis, why can't we somehow, and we didn't know how at the time, how can we hack into this connection, into this nerve connection between the brain and the diaphragm, and activate this breathing? Why can't we make patients breathe again that can't breathe today? We are stimulating like other organs like the heart, and why is nobody taking care of the diaphragm? So we set out and tried it. We did it. And it didn't work that well in the beginning, for full disclosure. So we had to understand physiology, we had to understand technology, and there was a lot of interface knowledge which got lost in translation. So we had to simulate electromagnetic fields, test them, didn't work that well, go back to bench, redesign our technology, and finally we had a coil and a magnetic stimulation technology to which the nerve would respond. However, we also had to learn the language. I mean, the brain and the diaphragm, they are talking to each other in a very unique pattern, and the signal pattern needs to be right so that the nerve will understand this. Today, we work with the best clinics in the world. They apply our device, and patients who did not breathe before start breathing again. So our first therapy is just like a breathing muscle workout. We learned, however, during the journey, we cannot just activate and potentially train the diaphragm, but we can also modulate breathing. So create any tidal volume we want, at least in healthy patients. And this is what ventilators are doing today. They pump air into the lung, and this is something that can be naturally done by the diaphragm. So this technology definitely has the potential to revolutionize ventilation as a field. And my bet is that there will be no ventilator in 20 years from now that does not have at least a diaphragm stimulation option incorporated in it. This. This is exciting. So what's in it for you and me? I can just say that sporticians have approached me and singers, hey, could I do a diaphragm workout to increase my performance? I don't know, a couple of years more, we might be there. The field of neuromodulation as a whole is really exciting too, because if we can learn to speak to our nerves early on, that really empowers us to go much more early intervention before diseases occur. A partner of us is already stimulating for the indication of depression. And a couple of years ago, drugs were used in the same indications. So this is really an emerging, exciting field. But this is not just about technology, right? This is about helping people, patients to breathe. For you and me, pause every day, take a deep diaphragm breath, enjoy those complex interactions and functionalities that go on inside your body for every breath you take. Let's enjoy every breath of life. Thank you.